فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The author رحمه الله, he started his book by saying, الإمام المجدد شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب أجزل الله له المثوبة والمغفرة. He started his book by saying بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Why did he do that? He did that اقتداء بكتاب الله تعالى. He's following Allah سبحانه وتعالى in that. وتأسيا بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he's also following the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإنه كان يبدأ كتبه بالبسملة. The Prophet used to start his books and his messages with the basmala. As Imam al-Bukhari, he narrated in his Sahih, hadith number 7. And Imam Muslim, hadith 1773 min hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas. On the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, Bukhari brought it in Kitab al-Bad' al-Wahi, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote a letter, and he started with it, the letter he sent to Hiraqla, عظيم الروم, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, من محمد عبد الله ورسوله إلى هرقل عظيم الروم. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here is sending a letter, and he's starting with Bismillah. So the author, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he is following the path of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also he is following Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, because Allah started the Quran. If you open the Mus'haf right now, the first surah that comes out is Surah Al-Fatiha, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he started with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. There's also another hadith with the scholars, they also bring in these kind of munasabat. They also bring it here, which is a hadith al-qawliya fi mas'alati al-basmala. The hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they attribute to him that he said, kullu amrin dhi balin la yubda' fihi bi bismillahi fa huwa abtar. Any matter that a person does not start with it, bismillahi, then that matter is deficient. If you don't start with Bismillah in a matter, then that matter is deficient. This hadith, an Imam Khatib al-Baghdadi, he narrated in his Kitab al-Jami' li-akhlaq al-Rawi wa adab al-Sami'. An Imam al-Subki, he brought it in his book Tabaqat al-Shafi'iyyah al-Kubra. He brought it in the Muqaddimah. On the authority of Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This hadith is excessively weak, because it's from the narration of Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Imran, who is very well known as Ibn al-Jundi. Khatib al-Baghdadi, he said in his Tariq al-Baghdad, كان يضعف في روايتي ويطعن عليه في مذهبي ويطعن عليه في مذهبي. He was weakened in his narration, and he was also criticized for his madhab. Meaning he had the madhab of tashayyu', Shi'ism. Ibn al-Arraq, he said in his Tanzih al-Shari'ah al-Marfu'ah, he said, Shi'iyun ittahamahu Ibn al-Jawzi bil-wada. He's a Shi'i. Ibn al-Jawzi accused him of a fabricator. He fabricates. The hadith also, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he weakened it, as he transmitted it from the author Al-Futuhat al-Rabbaniya. Al-Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani rahimahullah, it is the first hadith he started with it, his Kitab Irwa' al-Ghalil. His Kitab Irwa' al-Ghalil, Sheikh al-Albani, the first hadith, he brought it in that book of his, and he weakened it. Why? What benefit does it hold to start with the basmala? What benefit does it hold to start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? Number one is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he started his book with the basmala. كتاب الله تعالى حيث بدأ بالبسملة. Allah's book, the basmala was started with it. And the second one, as I said before, is ما كان يصنعه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في كتاباته إلى الملوك. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to start with the basmala in the letters he would send to the leaders. The grammatical analysis of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bismillah, Bismi is jar and a majrur. The ba is a harfu jar. The ism is majrur. The jar and the majrur, they have to be connected to something. What are they both attached to? And what are they connected to? But if you say in the name of Allah what? It has to be connected to something. The scholars, they said, it is something muqaddar, something that cannot be seen. It is also mutaakhiran, it is delayed. And this goes against the qa'idatul nuhat. This goes against the principles that the grammarians put. The grammarians, they say, that في متعلق الجار والمجرور أنه يقدر مقدما. The qa'ida is that which is connected to the jar and the majrur should be hidden, but it has to be مقدم, has to be before. That is the أصل, not متأخرا. But the reason here is why the qa'ida has been broken here is لِيَحْصُلَ التَّبَرُّكِ بِالْبَدْءِ بِالْبَسْمَلَةِ, so one can find barakah. In starting with the basmallah. To get barakah from it, that you say it first before what you want to say. So in the name of Allah I eat, or in the name of Allah I stand. So the barakah comes by you saying in the name of Allah before anything else. What is the type of thing that is hidden? What is it that's hidden? وَأَمَّا نَوْعِيَّةُ الْمُقَدَّرِ, the grammarians, they are all in dispute regarding this matter. There's a khilaf. Some say ism, some say fi'il. But that which we choose is that it's a fi'il. It's a verb. And then again they disputed, what type of verb is it? Is it a general verb? Or is it مَا يُنَاسِبُ الْمَقَامِ, a verb that is befitting into the place. Is there any, should we make a general verb? Should we say in the name of Allah I start? Start, it can be used for anything. Or should we use a fi'il which is يُنَاسِبُ الْمَقَامِ? So when you're eating you say in the name of Allah I eat. When you're reading you say in the name of Allah I'm reading. And then when you're reading you say in the name of Allah I'm reading. So you use a verb that is يُنَاسِبُ الْمَقَامِ, or should you use a general verb? We'll say بِمَا يُنَاسِبُ الْمَقَامِ, that which befits the place. So for example, فَالَّذِي يَقْرَأُ, the one who's reading, يَكُونُ التَّقْدِيرُ, the verb that's مُقَدَّر is going to be بِسْمِ اللَّهِ أَقْرَأ. وَالَّذِي يَكْتُبُ, the one who's writing, he will say بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ أَكْتُبُ. And the remaining verbs are like that. So we spoke about the jar and the majrur. What about Bismillah Allah? What about Allah? Allah is an ism min asma'i Allah ta'ala al-khassatu bihi. Alamun ala dhati Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah is a name from the names of Allah that are specific to Him. And the meaning of it is al-ma'luh hubban wa ta'zima. The one who is worshipped. He's worshipped. With the two pillars of worshipping. Which is what? كمال الذل مع كمال المحبة. The person, he loves Allah تبارك وتعالى and he completely humiliates himself for Allah تبارك وتعالى and honors him. That is Allah. الرحمن اسم من أسماء الله تعالى. It's a name from the names of Allah تبارك وتعالى. And we can take the first opinion, which is Ar-Rahman is what? Dhu-Rahmati al-Wasi'a, the one whose mercy is vast. He does it for the believers and for the non-believers. They also come under that one. That's Ar-Rahman. That's one opinion. And then Ar-Rahim becomes Musilu rahmatahu ila man yasha'u min ibadi. He gives his mercy to whoever he wills from his creation, not for everyone. And this is specific to the believers. This is specifically to the what? To the believers. Because Allah said about the believers, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. And to the believers, Allah is Rahim. He didn't say Rahman. Surah Al-Ahzab, Ayah 43. That's one opinion. The second opinion that can be taken, which is what? That the word Ar-Rahman is صفة ذاتية and Ar-Rahim is صفة فعلية. That Ar-Rahman, it is a صفة. It's a characteristics that is within Allah that is not connected to His will. Whereas Ar-Rahim is a characteristic that is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. He does it whenever he wills. It's an action of his, he does it. Whereas Ar-Rahman is like As-Sam'u wal-Basar, like hearing and seeing, they are sifa dhatiyya. Whereas Ar-Rahim is going to be sifa fi'liya, which is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he speaks when he wills. Those are the two opinions that are taken regarding it. Ibn al-Qayyim, he brings it in his kitab, Bada'i' al-Fawa'id. First volume, page 24. First volume, page 24, you can find that there. The Shaykh, after the basmala, after saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the Shaykh, rahimahullah, he said, I'lam no, rahimakallahu, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala have mercy on you. The Shaykh said, I'lam no, رحمك الله. May Allah have mercy upon you. هذا الدعاء, that's a supplication. من المصنف, it's a supplication and a دعاء from the author, رحمه الله. For who? لك أيها القارئ. Oh, you who is reading. The Shaykh has made a دعاء for you. And he also has made دعاء for the what? المستمع, the one who's listening. The one who's reading this book, the Shaykh made dua for you. He said, may Allah have mercy upon you. He's also made dua for the one who's reading. And this really shows us, وَهُوَ يَدُلُّ عَلَى مَحَبَّتِهِ لَكَ وَشَفَقَتِهِ عَلَيْكَ. This shows us the love that the Shaykh has for us. And the concern and the worry that he has for us. And this, اعلم رحمك الله. And in other places of his books, he says, اعلم رحمني الله وإياك. وهذا فيه تلطف. In this is what? In this is to show how kind and tender the Shaykh is, رحمه الله. And this also shows us إلى أن مبنى هذا العلم على التلطف. That this knowledge, that knowledge is based upon kindness and generosity and tenderness. And that one should be very merciful towards those who he teaches. الرحمة بالمتعلمين. That one has to be very merciful towards those who he teaches. And the Shaykh, he was known that he would use these types of statements. يَسْتَعْمِلُ مِثْلَ هَذِي الْعِبَارَاتِ كَثِيرًا. He uses it a lot. Sometimes he will say, أَعْلَمْ أَرْشَدَكَ اللَّهُ لِطَاعَتِي. Sometimes he will say, أسأل الله الكريم رب العرش العظيم أن يتولاك في الدنيا والآخرة. In his قواعد ال... قواعد الأربعة. And in other places he does else. The scholars, they used to narrate. وكان العلماء يروون ويروون لمن بعدهم في من طلب الإجازة في الحديث. The scholars before, they would narrate and it would also be narrated to them a particular narration if they wanted to seek إجازة in a hadith. The scholars would all start with one hadith. There was a hadith that the scholars would start with. And that is the hadith of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, in which he said, الراحمون يرحمهم الرحمن. Those who are merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be merciful towards them. Abu Dawood, At-Tirmidhi, and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal in his Musnad, they all narrated it. من حديث عبد الله بن عمر بن العاص أبو عيسى الترمذي, he said, هذا حديث حسن صحيح. This hadith, it is known as, وهذا الحديث هو المعروف عند أهل العلم بالحديث المسلسل. This hadith is known as a hadith مسلسل. It's what we took in بيقونية. مسلسل قل ما على وصف أتى مثل أما والله أنبأني الفتى كذاك قد حدثنيه قائما وبعد أن حدثني تبسما. مسلسل is when narrators, عبارة عن تتابع رجال الإسناد وتواردهم فيه واحدا بعد واحد على صفة أو حالة واحدة. They would pass a narration to one another in a particular description or in a particular situation. And of course it's of types. ينقسم ذلك إلى ما يكون صفة للرواية وتحمل وإلى ما يكون صفة للرواة أو حالة لهم. Ibn Salah, he brought it in the 33, because Ibn Salah in his مقدمة ابن صلاح, which is also known as علوم الحديث, he made it the 33rd type. And الإمام السخاوي in فتح المغيث, the third volume, page 57, in the شرح of the كتاب ألفية العراقي, he brings it there. That it means that the narrators will pass to each other a narration in a particular way. For instance, the Prophet ﷺ narrated a hadith, and when he finished the hadith, he asked the companions, why don't you ask me why I am laughing or smiling? He said this to his companions. And then the companions, they said, Ya Rasulullah, why were you smiling? Why were you laughing for? And then the Prophet said, Allah, he smiled and laughed. And so, every narrator will say the same thing. He would say to his students, why don't you ask me why I am smiling or laughing? And they would say, why are you? And he would say, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when I heard it from him, he had said the same to us. So every narrator will do the same. This is called musalsal. This hadith is from those hadith which are musalsal. Ar-rahimuna yarhamhum ar-rahman. Why is it musalsal? It's musalsal because every narrator would say to his students that the first hadith I heard was this. Every narrator would say that. He would say, أول حديث سمعته منه, the first hadith I heard was this. The first hadith I heard was this. The first hadith I heard was this. Because to the top, the companion who heard it from the Prophet, he said that this was the first hadith I heard. And so everyone made, they would say, this is the first hadith I was given. And so this hadith has a significance to us right now, which is what? The author brought it in the beginning. Mercy and al-Rahma. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala have what? Rahma on you. There's a benefit we can also take about the word rahimakallahu. So we took a hadith benefit. There's another benefit which we can take, which is a usuli benefit. A usuli benefit. Usul al-fiqh based benefit, which is rahimakallahu is jumla khabariya lafzan, insha'iyya ma'nan. Rahimakallah, the form it comes in is a statement. It's a statement. Rahimakallahu. It's a statement, meaning rahimakallahu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has had mercy on you. That's what it means if we translate it. It's a statement. It's mentioning a matter to you. But what is intended from it is what? Insha'iyyah ma'nan. What is intended from it is a supplication. Insha'i is a talab or a du'a. Or amar or a nahi. All of those are what? Insha'i. Insha'i is anything which you can't say, kadhabta, you lied. Insha'i means anything you can't say to a person, you've lied. When a person makes a dua, can you say you lied? No. If a person tells you to do something, can you say you lied? No. If the person requests something from you, can you say you lied? No. Then all of that is called insha'i. Khabar means a statement. A person can lie. You can say, you've lied to me. Are you with me? So jazakallahu khairan is the same. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the same. All of those are what? Khabariyatun lafdan insha'i. So the author rahimahullah, he said rahimakallahu jumla khabariyya lafdan insha'iyya ma'nan. Rahimakallahu, the author said jumla, which is khabariyya lafdan insha'iyya ma'nan. So it's a dua. Dua for who? Lilmutta'allimi, the one who is seeking knowledge. It's a dua for him. Now the question that we have here is, the Shaykh is trying to say, may Allah have mercy upon you, meaning, may Allah forgive you from the sins that you have done in the past, and may Allah also give you tawfiq, wa waffaqaka wa asamaka fima yustaqbal. And in the future to come, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala give you tawfiq, meaning give you the ability to stay away from sins in the future. And may He also forgive you for the past sins. That is when rahmah is mentioned by itself, that's what it means. هذا إذا أفردت الرحمة. When the rahmah is mentioned by itself, that's what it means. When it's mentioned alone, that's what it means. وإذا قرنت بالمغفرة. But if rahmah and al-maghfira are both mentioned together, they are both brought together, then al-maghfira means may Allah forgive you for the past and that which you have done. فَالْمَغْفِرَةُ لِمَا مَضَى. وَالرَّحْمَةُ and mercy is لِمَا يُسْتَقْبَلُ بِالتَّوْفِيقِ لِلْخَيْرِ وَالسَّلَامَةِ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ. And al-rahmah then means the future to come, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you a tawfiq to come with good and protect you from the sins. That is when they come together. So what does Al-Rahma and Maghfira, both of them, what are they known as? What was the qa'idah that we took? إِذَا اجْتَمَعَا افْتَرَقَا وَإِذَا افْتَرَقَا اجْتَمَعَا. Does that make sense? It's like Al-Iman and Al-Islam. Al-Miskeen and Al-Faqir. And words like that. The word Al-Rahma and Al-Maghfira, they hold that principle. We will stop there for inshallah ta'ala for today, and we will carry on tomorrow bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.